he's a gorilla by about, like, what, 400 pounds, something like that.
Yeah.
It's, you know, it's a lot heavier. It can grow to about 10 feet tall. But gorillas have a lot more strength.
Yeah.
And also...
explosive strength.
Well, they've got explosive strength, but what we also have to consider is the fact that a gorilla is very smart. Now, here's my hypothesis.
We're the closest animals to us? Out of the two, especially.
Probably, yeah.
Out of the two. Out of the bear and the gorilla. The gorilla's more like us.
Excuse me, in my humility.
J. Robin, massive bear.
The phrase is otter.
I've got a thing about otters, but I'll leave that for another podcast. But anyway, continue.
Yeah, so, here is my thing. So, like, gorillas have a lot more intelligence to them. Now, we've seen that we can teach gorillas things like sign language and have it fully understand what it means. Why don't we just learn how to teach a gorilla some martial arts?
So the gorilla gets prep time.
And the gorilla can get
prep surely
that's not fair.
Well, no, but the bear gets prep time as well. Yeah. So who could have the better fight camp?
Do we tell the bear that you're fighting the gorilla? And we tell the gorilla, hey, let's put you into a fight camp for 6 months because you're going to UFC. Yeah. That doesn't seem barely fair.
I mean, to be fair, is that kind of like what they did with Brock Lesnar when he went to the UFC?
Pop. I mean, if we can all agree
on... I'm glad this is a visual podcast and you see me, like, spitting my juice out.
Oh, yeah, we can maybe agree to disagree on who would win the fight, but we can all unanimously agree that Kevin Williams needs to book this for the fight before Christmas.
Book it, Commissioner.
T-shirt's coming soon, hopefully.
Yeah, that's what we need. The worldwide though, fun getting on us instead of Kinetic.
We're going to take down the WWF boys. So yeah, welcome to the latest edition of the SCW podcast. I am Patrick Patelski, joined by my lovely co-host.
Duke Cannon.
That's your name, yep.
sorry, I was just still too busy.
You were thinking about who's going to win.
I'm still too busy. It's rocking my mind a bit too much. But yeah, I am Duke Cannon, one half of Game On.
Yep.
And co-host of this podcast. Mm-hmm.
And we've heard a bit from him already. But our guest is the Rainbow Renegade, as you're now going by.
Yeah.
Very nice name, I like it. Mr. J. Robin, how you doing?
I'm good, thank you very much. Yeah. Thanks for having me.
That's okay. How's your neck after that match with ADM? It looks very, very sore.
A week the move, it's a lot better.
Good.
But at the time it was not a fun night.
What an effort though, by the way.
Thank you.
Like, I think you proved a lot of people wrong. Said it on commentary with JP Hamilton. You took the fight at 6 hours notice. Yeah. Locker rooms offered this match. Caleb Valhalla suddenly come down with an illness. First man with his hand up. Never give anyone a chance. Give me ADM.
And I think the thing as well is, like, knowing how fiercely ADM was wanting to face Caleb as well, and having someone else who is not Caleb, like, in his stead, that's just gonna piss him off. Let's be honest.
Oh yeah, he was not happy when he came out and saw me. But you know, like, I've been looking for an opportunity to prove myself and let people know who J. Robin is, and I thought this was a good opportunity. And quite frankly, like, I don't like bullies.
No,
I don't like people who throw the weight around. And ADM is certainly comes across to me both backstage and when I see him out in the ring as a bully. Now, yeah, he beat me, but he's going to remember, like, the fight that I put up. He's not going to take me as lightly as he did.
Definitely not.
As he did that time, if we ever face off again. Like, 6 hours notice is not a lot of time to prepare for a man like ADM, but I'm just glad that everyone seems to feel like when I stepped up, that I showed that I deserve to be here.
Yeah, you definitely did. And then some. Proud of you, mate. Well done.
Thank you. Definitely.
Well done.
Thank you.
Well done, that one, man.
It's looking forward, though. We've got a show to promote, Duke. This is why we do this podcast. But before that, we're going to learn a bit more about Mr. J. Robin. Mm-hmm. And we're going to kick off with your 5 questions of doom.
Yeah, so if you are joining us for the first time, the 5 questions of doom are 5 quick-fire interview questions so that we can get to know our guests just a little bit better. So,
whether they'll be answered quick-fire or not is another thing.
It's
well, I'm fine with that.
I mean, they've kind of started going a little bit less quick fire than we originally hoped.
I enjoy long form.
I had Ewan's podcast interview with Ewan, and Ewan's answers was like listening to War and Peace.
Yeah,
but it's I will try and be quick, but.
You brought notes. You're not going to get caught.
I've got notes.
You want to get his brother.
I got notes so I can just answer these questions and not like ramble too much. Okay. But anyone who's ever met me knows that that is an absolute lie and this will not work out.
I appreciate the effort.
These were made an hour before coming.
Well, less notice than you had for ADM. You've had a few weeks to prepare for this, and you wrote your notes an hour ago.
I was having a belly. I was like, oh, I've got a long weekend. I'm going to take some time. I'm just going to light some stuff up, and I'll go out have it. And then I had a really good weekend. I've been going out, spending time with my boyfriend, and nice. Just doing stuff. So like, I was not had the time, and I was just like, I've got an hour before I get picked up. I should probably write something down. So this was very quickly scribbled on the bed, looking at the results for the pay-per-view that I've picked. For
I mean, to be fair, you're probably the first person to come with notes. Yeah. I've never seen anyone else actually taking the notes along with them. So we appreciate the preparedness.
I would have had notes if I did have prep time. But I didn't, because Dickie Divers, the coward that he is, pulled out of the podcast last minute.
Yeah.
And
again, he says it was due to traffic, but
yeah.
I mean, you can slash your own tyres as well and say, oh, well, my tyres have been slashed. Can't go up to Dundee. Can't come up and see the boys.
Yeah. But.
Man's a champion. Yeah. Is he?
Oh, he's got champ shit to do.
Yeah.
champion stuff to do. Yeah.
He would have even got champion's advantage as well. Like he would have gotten two choices on this podcast for the first question, and that first question is: if you were stuck on a desert island and you could take any pay per view to keep you occupied while you were stuck there, what pay per view would you take and why? Or a premium live event
for the kids out there?
For the kids out there,
we're down with the kids.
No, these were pay per views. I'm going a bit. One's going to show my age a little bit, but I've got an honourable mention, which is going to be Money in the Bank 2011.
Very topical.
Yeah.
For reference, we are recording.
Considering what happened last night.
For reference, we are recording this the day after Survivor Series, where R-Truth made his return, baby.
I'm Randy Orton.
Oh, no, what
day? Forget about the Viper. It's snack time.
It's snack time. I laughed far too much at that meme.
Yeah, so that show, I think, it's going, like, literally looking at the results before I came here, I was like, that's a 5-match card. But it's like, I was like, surely there was more on it, but there wasn't really.
Was it 2 Money in the Bank matches? Was it that?
Two ladder matches, world title match, and there was a women's divas title match.
Yes.
Before
Stephanie McMahon invented women's wrestling.
Yes.
Yes.
She invented women.
Oh, yes.
Gloria Steinem, eat your heart out. You're nothing compared to the feminist icon that is Stephanie McMahon.
What, I mean, what even were the suffragettes?
So yeah, like that is just like the SmackDown ladder match is won by Daniel Bryan, but like the people in that, Daniel Bryan, dashing Cody Rhodes, not, you know, like dashing, like when he had a mustache for some reason.
That was great.
Heath Slater, Gabriel Kidd, Kane, Sin Cara, Sheamus, and Wade Barrett. Like, basically, you've got half the Nexus in there.
Yeah.
Great, and great match. Daniel Bryan obviously went on to win the belt a few months later.
Oh, and he beat Big Show after Big Show beat Henry? Was that that?
Was that way, or was it the other way down?
Because this was like Hall of Pain Mark Henry.
Yeah.
And then Big Show finally got a big win, and then instantly got cashed on.
Yeah. The Law one was Alberto Del Rio, Alex Riley, Evan Bourne, Jack Swagger, Kofi, Miz, R-Truth, and Lay. Of course, R-Truth.
What a stacked match. Well, R-Truth,
of course, making this the turn again. But yeah, like, ADR won that. Like,
noble prick.
And like, two ladder matches on a show that I like, still, you can go back, just put those matches on.
Yeah.
They're great matches to watch.
Yep.
You can't always say that about ladder matches all
the
time.
No, that's true.
Because they can be a bit like carnage, and it's hard to follow so many guys in both these matches, and it's just a great thing. And then like Christian versus Orton for the world heavyweight title,
yes.
And then Punk versus Cena, of course,
yes.
Kicking off the Summer of Punk,
the second
that flared out like 2 weeks later. Yeah. But it was great, and like that's all. Like as a mod in modern era, that's something that I a pay per view that I can watch anytime.
Yeah, it was a
good
but night.
My all time favorite pay per view of all time is Royal Rumble '94.
Oh, okay.
So there's multiple reasons. One, it was my cousin had sort of got out of wrestling. This is like 98, 99. My aunt had all these tapes, WrestleMania, Royal Rumble, SummerSlams, gave them to me.
Yeah.
Royal Rumble 94 was the one of the first ones I watched. And I just like, I was like, it's all these guys that I recognised because I was out of, I hadn't got really back into wrestling properly yet. And it was like, it's like Owens on the show, Bret's on the show, Razor Ramon, Shawn Michaels, Kevin Nash as Diesel, Undertaker, Yokozuna. So it's like all these guys that I kind of recognised from like a few years before. I'd never saw this show before, and like I think I wore that tape out. Just such a, and it's like it's the first time I ever saw Luna Vachon, who at the time terrified me. Probably got a chance to meet her in person before she died, she probably would actually just like eat me alive because like she's that scaly. But she was on the show as like managing Bam Bam Bigelow versus Tatanka. Tatanka was kind of like became like a big thing for me for like a few months in 98, 99. Don't know why. I hear this like chops to the head are quite dangerous, but in general, that was like one of the first matches on the show, and I'm like, okay, Tatanka, I love this guy, he's amazing. And then it followed up with like it's the Quebecers versus Owen and Bret, and they'd already started to tease the Owen Bret thing, and then at the end of that match, you know, he kicks Bret's leg out and totally goes out and does that promo, and he's got the spit hanging out the side of his mouth and that, and he, like it's a great, like it was the start of Owen becoming a, you know, a star, essentially, and then it goes
like a bit of a breakout for him.
Yeah, then you got because obviously, like you know, Mania is like 3 months away at that point. Bret Owen at Mania is amazing, and then the SummerSlam match in the cage is that year as well was fantastic. But like, this is the start of it. Laser versus IRS for the IC belt is probably like my least favorite match on that show. I love Scott Hall, I love Laser Ramon, but it's IRS, and like, no offense to Mike the Thunder, but like, it's a tax man. Like, no one likes paying their taxes.
It's the ultimate heel.
He should have been in a tag team with The Undertaker. And they should have called Death and Taxes.
Oh, Death and Taxes.
Death and Taxes.
And Undertaker came in with $1 million.
Exactly.
It was all, there.
Undertaker and IRS, Death and Taxes. It would have been amazing.
Yeah.
But, and then it's like followed up by Yoko taking a casket, which is fantastic. Taker dies at the end. And then Luger and Bret win the Lumble. And I remember thinking, like, oh my god, a triple threat,
yeah, maybe
in 94? Not what happened at all. But like, that's where my brain was, because I'd saw triple threats by that point. But that was like kind of like, but yeah, Loyal Number 94, I just think it's such an easy show to watch. It's so enjoyable, and everyone on it, especially even in the Lumble match, which again, is kind of like, lads, can get a bit confusing to watch sometimes. Like, everyone knows what they're doing, and you can follow it, and it's just so much fun. And like, random Japanese guys show up, and then you've got like the I think Ric Flair's in that. Ric Flair left WWE the next night, losing to Mr. Perfect, who I think eliminated them. And it says there's all the stories that WWE were doing at the time just all conglomerated in this one match. And yeah, Royal Rumble 94 is, I think, one of the greatest pay per views of all time. I'm sure there's people online who are going, this guy knows nothing.
You can see why I used to go on with Ewan. He was also an early 90s Rumble pick, wasn't it? I think it was 93 you picked.
I think he picked 93, yeah.
Yeah, 93's a good one as well. That's the one Yoko won. I had that tape as well. Yeah. But for some reason, I watched it after 94. And even though they say 93 and 94 on the boxes, when I put them on the shelf in order, 93 always came after 94 for some reason, because apparently as a 9-year-old, I was an idiot. As a 30-something now, I am also an idiot, but I then knew that I was particularly stupid. So
interesting as well, we've now had Royal Rumble 93 and Royal Rumble 94.
No one will ever pick Royal Rumble 95.
But nobody's picked 92 yet, and that's widely considered like the best one.
I mean, that is
that's
controversial take. It's the worst Rumble of all time. I am not a fan of Rumble 92. It's like, yeah, it's impressive for Flair winning the belt, but everything else is kind of just...
It's just
bowling to
sore
me.
Sore loser, Hulk Hogan.
It's bowling to me. I would rather watch 94.
Before we get into that for another hour, we'll move on. So, Duke's second question to him is, if you could form a tag team with any character, fictional, non-fictional, wrestling, non-wrestling, who would it be and why?
Like a proper full-on tag team, I'd actually pick someone that I've already tagged with. And that... probably always surprise you guys, but it's going to be Ewan.
You going to go back to Ewan G. Mackey?
I would say when I got back into less than the indie level and watching Scottish wrestling, Ewan G. Mackey was someone that I saw and went, this guy gets it. He's different. He knows what he's doing, and he's just he was so fascinating to me. And that's, you know, like, that's one of the reasons why you could I think I ended up joining the Paladin was because of that. Was like that admiration, but also like understanding that what his message was, which was, you know, like, I'm underappreciated, and people should notice me and pay more attention to me. I feel that as well sometimes. I definitely felt like that prior to joining the Paladin, and definitely throughout it, there was definitely a thing of me feeling like, yeah, people don't care about me. No matter what I do, I work twice as hard to get half of the award. And it's exactly the sort of thing that Ewan said to me to get me to join. It's exactly the sort of thing that Dee took me in. And Ewan's a comedian, and he's been different people over the years. He's been a goblin of the skies. He's been a pilot, a goblin of the seas. He's been a clown. He's now a Teletubby. A long time thing with Ewan, where it was based on a thing of mutual respect, mm-hmm. rather than him wanting people to help him do his bidding. Yeah, I would love to do something like that, because I've saw the mind of the man. We found ourselves together again. I think it would be a very different dynamic, different situation. And yeah,
different paradigm.
Yes, we'd love to see. Yeah,
I mean, and that's the thing, is that the paradigm now is different to what it was even when I was in it with Holden and Valak. Like, that was like four guys, you know, including you in this, who did feel overlooked, who did feel that they weren't getting the accolades, I can't think of a better word for that, that they felt they deserved.
Opportunities, maybe.
Yeah. And the paradigm now is, I think Ewan realised that, you know, having guys who, while looked up to him and wanted his advice and that would help him out, now he's got someone who is a little pet for him to play with, who will do whatever he says and never question anything. And that's what he's got now. And if that's what Ewan wants to do with
Tom
Atlas, formerly known as Titanium, like, if that's what he wants to do with Tom, fine. But like, I don't think he'll reach the success he did with us in the group. I don't think that the paradigm, the neo paladin, the new neo paladin, like the new Midnight Express didn't work, the new Lockers didn't work, the new neo paladin ain't gonna work either.
But the new Nexus led to Money in the Bank 2011.
It did. The one time new in less than actually worked.
I mean, we did.
What about the New Day?
Oh
yeah, but they were never. They started as new. They were never the second version of the New Day.
The Day. We did see a potential crack in Ewan's normally sort of stoic exterior at the end of his match at the last FCW show. He's called it on commentary. There seemed to be a bit of a remnant of feeling there, remaining with Bochico. Yeah. So there is. Like, for there is still something there, so you never know. Maybe down the line, he might remember the days that he had with you and might think, right, let's maybe give this another go. But yeah, it's a long road, we'll see what happens.
I mean, I'm not gonna lie, I was kind of surprised to see him.
Not as surprised as Tom Atlas was, he was raging.
Yeah,
that's not what he signed up for, I don't think.
I don't think it is. I remember there being something that Ewan said on his episode of the podcast where he said he'd be disappointed if Tom doesn't turn on him at some point. If Tom was that surprised, I'm not a betting man by any means, but I don't know if there's maybe going to be something appearing sort of down the line. It seems a bit too raw for me to like ignore.
There's definitely something. Not all is not well. Like I said, I don't think Tom's getting what he signed up for. I don't think he's maybe that's what I think that's what you guys found out when you joined as well. You were like, this isn't what we signed up for, and eventually you guys said no thanks.
The thing is that as much as I've just said, you know, Ewan is all these things and that, he's also a liar.
Yeah. Well, he sucked you in, maybe the same way that he sucked
Tom in. With this promise of like fame and fortune and riches, like and like, you know, that like, you'll get your opportunities. You know, I had one opportunity when I was in the Paladin, and it was against Duke and Spike Tierney at Neymarcy for the junior heavyweight title. At the end of that show, I come out with Holden, with Valak, And we are there to support Marky and help him.
Mm-hmm. Against Johnny Lyons, wasn't it?
We all get sent to the back. After the match, you know, when Brian fast counted and Kevin Williams, rightly so, reversed the decision. What does Ewan say? Boys, get him. Ewan says he never told us to do anything. What was that? Mm. What was that? Ewan told us be there to support me. Ewan told us afterwards, get out there and beat him up. Didn't work out the way we wanted it to. We ended up getting beat up ourselves. But, you know, Ewan told us to be there. At the start of that show, I say, I've got friends here as well. Mm-hmm. My friends were Valak, Holden, and Ewan. Like, acquaintances, whatever. Where were they in my title match? They weren't there anywhere to be found. And that's one of those things where that's where the clacks started to form. That's where I started to see things a bit differently. I still supported you, and I was thinking, you know, maybe it's just a blip.
Yeah.
Maybe it's just a moment. But I'm here now. I'm not in the paradigm.
No.
And it wasn't because you can say he kicked us out. We walked out. He told us to leave. We walked out. The next time we come out, he tries to say, "Oh, we kicked you out of the paradigm." No, we walked out on you, man.
Revising.
You kicked us to the. You told us to go back. You told us to go to the back, and we went to the back and went, "Screw this guy. We'll all leave him." Because right now he's a megalomaniac who's losing his grip on things.
Mm-hmm. I'd be struggling to deal with that.
Yeah, absolutely.
I mean, it's a form of gaslighting.
And what did he do at the end of the night? He lost his belt. He lost the paradigm. He lost the belt, and he lost his grip on the alley.
Hey, don't talk about losing belts, man.
We'll get to that.
Yeah.
So, go for it, Duke. Next question.
Let's move on to question three. Now, question three is, if you could have a match against anyone living or dead, who would it be?
Sean Waltman.
Oh, okay.
X-Pac, 123 Kid, 6, any combination of those names that he's had in other companies he's worked. When I got back into wrestling in 1999, he was the European champion, or just lost it to Shane McMahon. This is just sort of post-wrestling.
The best belt.
The best, yeah, it's one of those.
We've got this in common.
The European title belt, the WWF European title belt from 1997 to 2002, whenever it lasted, is for me one of the most beautiful belts that they've ever had.
I think Billy is also a big fan of the European title.
When I did a podcast interview with him, he had it in the background on the video, and I was just like, that is a fantastic belt. That and the big gold are the two best belts.
Whenever I'm around at your flat, I just kind of go and I just put it on, and I'm like, one day.
Patrick has visited a few times.
He has tried
to avail himself of my belts.
And I'm just like, we can just put an FCW sticker on this, and like we've got another championship. Like, book it, commissioner.
But that whole thing, like, Sean Waltman and Shane McMahon at that time, I don't know what it was about those two. I think Waltman definitely had a punk attitude that I definitely sort of gravitated to, the whole DX thing, which had kind of broken off by that point. But I was like, that whole thing and just everything he does in the ring, and I went back and watched stuff that he did, the match with Bret Hart, stuff in WCW with Eddie Guerrero, things like that. I just really enjoy all that stuff, and I'd love to just like do something with him because he's such a good wrestler. Like, I'd lose. Like, I know I'd lose. But I think it'd be a lot of... I think it'd probably be the funnest match of my career, just getting to actually, like, wrestle my heel of 9-year-old Jay.
Which version of the many iterations of Shot?
I mean,
obviously, it would be X-Factor, X-Pac. But if we're not picking that, which would it be?
X-Factor, X-Pac has the best music.
You are dealing with the X-Factor.
Yeah. I got everything I want. I love that tune. And then
you come out to Follow Me.
Yeah.
And then it's just the Uncle Cracker party.
I remember I was at a training session one time with Spike, and we were talking about music, wrestling music, and we were going, oh, this, like, from this list on YouTube of like the worst wrestling tunes of all time, and we were like 10, 9, 8, whatever, went through those 10 things, and I was just like, and I'd been going on about how Uncle Clacker's X-Factor theme was the best.
Yeah, it was number one.
This is the worst music, and I was just like, this part knows nothing about music. But yeah, like,
you have to appreciate Uncle Cracker, man.
Yeah, I think if I was the
peak Sean.
Led red DX outfit from like late 98 X Pac. That
was that when Kane was like sort of in DX.
This was just before Kane. This would be like the Jeff Jarlett feud, right, okay, where like they shaved his Jeff Jarlett's head, yes, and Finkel was involved and stuff like that.
They should have went all in on X Pac and Kane. Kane, yeah, should have green Kane. No, green Kane, no. And DX would be great.
Blue Kane. I want to see blue Kane. Or yellow Kane. Yellow Kane.
Or he comes back as like a Prince gimmick and it's purple Kane. Purple Kane.
Put him in an orange version, have him come out to Eye of the Tiger.
See, like, I genuinely...
just like a massive Dundee United strip. If you like it.
Oh, can you imagine Kane playing for United?
Oh, get him up front. Kane, Glenn Kane and Harry Kane up front.
I do thoroughly support the idea of like treating Kane like the ninjas from Mortal Kombat and just doing color palette swaps.
Oh, like a Rainbow Renegade and Rainbow Kane.
Yes, yes, yes.
He'd love that. Yes, he'd have no issue with that at all.
Yes, absolutely. Kane would absolutely love to be Rainbow Kane.
Rainbow Kane. Oh, I have fun on this podcast. It's great. So, J. Robin, if you weren't a professional wrestler, if you could have gone down any other profession in life other than pro wrestling to make your living, what would it have been?
So, when I was my late teens, early 20s, I was kind of looking into doing stuff involving film and lighting.
Okay.
So, I think it would probably be something like that. I've always, like, I enjoy telling stories.
Yeah, I could see you as a writer.
I mean, I've written stuff in the past. I've got notebooks full of like ideas and like stories and stuff like that, because I can't write on a laptop. I can edit on a laptop. I can type up after I've written it, and
but you have to get like the idea,
yeah, pen and paper, yeah, it needs to be pen and paper or pencil. I need to write it down. I used to work a retail job and I would literally stand at the counter writing in a notebook like a story, and then I'll go help this customer, and then I'll immediately go write back, because like, what's like minimum wage, minimum effort.
Yep. I've been in,
you don't pay me enough to not do this. So
I was saying this to one of my colleagues in my job during the week. I used to work retail as well. I think it should be the new form of national service. So if anyone doesn't know, I used to have national service in
Sweden.
You have it in a lot of countries around the world still, where usually guys, men when they're like 18, they have to go off and join the army for a couple of years and do the national service. Then they can, you've done your bit for your country and come back into society. Bollocks to that. Go and work in a shop.
As someone who's worked in like retail when like in service jobs and that, like the level of abuse you get from people
crazy.
Is insane. And I think a lot of time it comes from people who have never had to work in a job like that. And I've said before to people, like, I think a national service where you have to work in a shop
Or a
cafe
restaurant,
or
something
a restaurant,
like that.
Something like that, where you have to deal with people, might actually teach you some like humility and like some basic,
I bet you're like the most
human decency.
I bet you're the most polite person when you go to a restaurant or a shop, right?
Absolutely.
Because you know what it's like.
Yeah,
I'm the same.
If I have to say, if something's long, I would do it. I will, and they've overcharged or something, I will raise it in the most polite manner possible, because I know it's not their fault.
Yeah.
It's a boring job that probably just got distracted. So I'm not gonna like think on it. But if I've also been that guy who's got really angry because you're trying to be polite, and some managers in particular love to argue and be like, no, that's never gonna happen. I'm like, no, that's no, you've messed up. I am trying to be polite here. Just fix your mistake and we can move on, and they will not. And so yeah, like I as nice as I can be when I go to the restaurant sometimes, it's not if I don't get my own way. If you can explain it to me why I can't get my own way, that's fine. But when you're just being an obstruction for the sake of being an obstruction, yeah, I'm not dealing with that. I will raise my voice and get all the attention.
The retail sucks, man.
Yeah. Speaking on the note of like national service, I think I'd rather do like a tour of Hellman than work at retail. I know what I would do.
I think I would rather do the retail, just because I don't think I could take orders from someone like that. Like, just like go out there and see what's going on. Like, I'm gonna go kip in my bed, mate. Like, I'm tired. It's hot.
Again, it sounds like retail at Christmas. The heaters are blasting. I'm taking orders from someone I don't respect.
There's one thing I would rather do less than those two things, though. Is I was doing some reading earlier on, and I came across...
You can read.
Yeah, I know, right? in two languages. I came across this bit of
it
information.
It doesn't count if it's Elvish from Lord of the
Rings. That's true. So I came across this interesting thing I found on the internet, and I think Mr. Callan will be very interested in this, because I've been threatening to drop some knowledge for a while about one of his hobbies and interests.
Okay.
The World of Warhammer. Okay. I found something.
I thought he was going to say World of Warcraft.
No, don't worry. Don't worry. No, I wouldn't do that to him. So I was reading about this planet in the Sanctus Reach, which has this apparently never-ending tidal wave going around the planet, and which means that the residents of that planet are permanently nomadic, and their whole lives are constantly spent outrunning a never-ending tidal wave. Yes, I got approval.
I'm impressed. You said
I got approval. Like, your dad never said that. No, no. Definitely never will now.
You showed me love in different ways. I got the odd nod every now and then. Well done, son.
That was a deep cut of war right there. Yeah. Right? Well, I'm impressed.
I know nothing of war. Warhammer.
I now know one thing.
I know it's called Warhammer.
There you go. Back to my dad, though. Shout out to my dad. This is a weird time. He went on holiday recently with my mum during the summer there, and he sent me a random photo of him wearing an FCW shirt that he bought and didn't tell me about. So he's clearly then found that Mad Merch sells the shirts, and then has bought one, and then has went to it wasn't like some sort of populous area where he could like really promote us. It was like just in a wee village in Greece.
There's like one person in Greece that saw that and went, I'm going to listen to the podcast.
And so first Slovakia, Duke, and now Greece. And we're taking over, and then we can bring the European title back, because there'll be a reason to.
Exactly, lads on tour.
Yeah. And then we build a rocket and go to this planet
just,
as a title win.
Just message Mad Match now, like, we need FCW stickers that will fit over this logo.
Yes, that's happening. So we move on to our final question.
We shall move on to the final question there. So, for your final question, Jay Robin, why do you wrestle?
It's a hard question to ask. It's like, why?
No, it's very easy to ask.
It can be answered in many different ways, depending on how you interpret the question.
It's a hard question to answer. Sorry. Messing that up. No. Thanks for pointing that out, Duke. I thought we were friends now.
Yeah. No, we are friends. Just,
it's hard to say, because my mother's asked me, like, why do you do this? Why do you want to have people pick you up and slam you into the ground? Why, you know, they...
Yeah, but you don't want that to happen. No, exactly. You want to avoid that.
Just like, why do you want to do this? Why do you want to hit people? Why do you want them... why are you allowing yourselves to be hit back and stuff like that? And it's just like, and honestly, this is going to sound such a bit. It's fun.
It's fun.
Yeah, it's fair. It's a fun thing to do.
Sort of talked about the stuff within the paradigm, the four of us together, there was a camaraderie between us.
Yeah.
And now I'm in a different locker room now. I'm sitting next to guys like Duke, like Spike Tierney. And it's a different. It's not the same camaraderie, but it's there, and we can talk and communicate about this thing that we are so passionate about doing. And I think that's the thing, that no one in wrestling is doing this if they're not passionate about it. And I think it can control your life in a way at times. Like, there's not a moment where I don't think about wrestling sometimes. Mm-hmm. Sorry to my amazing boyfriend, but yeah, like wrestling is just there, and like I take pride in standing up for what, you know, like this match with that I just had with ADM. like I said earlier, I don't like bullies. I don't like people who throw their weight around just because they think they can. So I'm doing it for like to show people who are like me that at every level you're going to come across bullies, but that doesn't mean that you should let them push you around and that you can't do something to stop them. I decide to do it by trying to beat them up. If you want to report them to HR, do that.
Yeah.
Whatever you have to do. And also, just in general, like, I want to leave something in less than, even at the level that we wrestle at. You know, we're not WWE, but we are FCW.
We are.
And I want to, like, I came into this company right after the pandemic, when everything started to open back up. And it was a great company to be around compared to where I'd been before, because I'd been in other places. And they're not as good as this. They just weren't. And I want to leave something behind for other people. Like, find something, leave something better behind for the people that are coming after you. And I think that's, like, in terms of FCW and how I, like, see, that I want people who come in after me who are like me, who are queer, who are a bit different, mm-hmm. who are alternative, as the kids say. nothing makes me sound older than saying "as the kids say," but like, for them to be able to come to shows and see someone like me and go, "Hey, I'm like that guy,"
yeah,
or "that guy has a message that I totally get and want to follow in my footsteps."
There's a place for me.
Yeah, the legacy I would like to leave behind is that of, I made it easier for people like me to come in, and to stand up for yourself and your community.
I like that. It's a good answer.
Thank you. Now I can fold up my notes. You really built up the notes. It's literally one piece of A4 paper. But
no, it's the Gettysburg Address. 500 pages long.
So shall we move on to A Fight Before Christmas?
I think we should move what on
name?
To
my favorite name for an FCW show we've had. Yeah. Like, it's so good.
Yeah. Good. So this is going to be on December 8th at the Empire Zone, the Tulloch Institution.
Is that what you call it?
Yeah.
Is that your
Empire Zone, mate? It's great. John, Mr. John Young, coined the term, first of all, and I've ran with it. Yeah.
Yeah.
Absolutely.
We're all nerds here in the Empire Zone, maybe.
God, that's like naming yourself after a comic book card.
I know, right?
Who would do that?
Who would ever do that?
What is Ray Jobin doing in the Empire Zone?
I mean, I say that, but like, as a nerd, like, I'm literally wearing like a rainbow Jurassic Park t-shirt.
Yeah.
Like, it's the logo and it's done in a label, and it's literally because I'm doing it. It's like, oh, this is like in association with the Scottish Lesson Network. Billy loves dinosaurs.
Yeah.
I need to have a dinosaur thing on the show.
Quick aside.
And I couldn't think of how to work it into my notes, so I just thought I'll wear the t-shirt.
I used to have an amazing chat playing back in my bachelor days.
Oh.
And it was the icebreaker, and it was, so what's your favourite dinosaur? Didn't really work a lot. I used to get the
funny looks.
I used to get yeah, and my pals would rip the piss off. It's a rubbish line. It's a rubbish line, Patrick. What are you doing? Never going to get anywhere with that. The guy that gave me more stick for that than anyone else used it on a girl for a joke, and I went to their wedding last year. So there you go.
60% of the time it works. All
exactly. Sex Panther. I just thought I'd throw that
it's
in there.
The Sex Panther. Yeah.
It's a Sex Panther chat of planes. Exactly. Yeah.
I might try this. Like, if I ever find myself looking for someone new.
There you go.
What's your favourite dinosaur?
Dude, please do it while wearing that t-shirt.
Just look at me going like, go away.
Luchasaurus, obviously. Or sorry, Killswitch as he's known now.
Killswitch? Ah.
He's been rechristened by Christian Cage.
Who's your favourite dinosaur? Jim Lawless, obviously.
So shall we talk about A Fight Before Christmas?
I think we better talk about Christmas.
Jay, you're the guest. I've got the card here in front of me.
Oh.
Which match would you like to talk about first?
Well, before we get into that, we will just quickly state again for anyone who's joining us for the first time, the order that we go through these matches will not reflect the order that they will appear on the card on the 8th of December at the Tulloch Institute. The only way for you to find out what order these matches are going to be in is by getting your tickets at faircitywrestling.com. com.
And obviously, card subject to change as well.
Card but is always
card subject. Is subject to change, absolutely. I have replaced a Viking.
Yeah. But also, it might be better. It might
like, I spent 6 hours preparing, and I thought, like, as I was going out, it says, I should have went to a costume shop and got a Viking helmet.
Were you tempted just to go send me out to kill him? Make him think that he's getting Caleb after all. Swerve him.
No, I did not. But I
you could have come out going, ooh!
I was tempted.
You're like, this guy got lost in the Waiting for Answers concert.
Obviously, I've got to know Caleb a bit recently, just backstage and that, and Caleb's a friend, so I was like, really, I was actually quite sad to see that he wasn't making the show. He was really unwell.
Get well soon, Caleb.
But at the same time, I was just like, oh, my you know, this guy that, you know, I've spoken to and like, I respect is not going to be here. And then it's just like, oh, by the way, you're doing this match instead. And I was like, oh. I mean, well, you know, it's just that I volunteered for it because I'm an idiot. But
then they were like, yeah, okay.
Yeah, once they said, you know, I was the first person to put my hand up. And once they were just like, yep, you're the guy.
You said yes.
Okay. I was expecting other people to put their hand up. And it's fun.
So let's go, Jay. Who are we picking for the first match to talk about? A wide array of matches.
Let's go for Omar Muhammad and Sebastian Asher.
I'm looking forward to this one. This has been building for a long time. So, of course, for those of you who don't know, Omar Muhammad, Sebastian Asher, former tag team partners as members of Glory Hunting Agencies. And during the summer, that came to an end?
It did. It came to an end after someone beat Glory Hunter Agencies. Yeah. Oh, yeah, it was Game On.
Yeah.
We beat them so hard that they kind of imploded.
Yeah.
And Omar was kicked out onto the curb.
Omar developed a conscience.
He did.
Yeah, he developed a conscience.
I think it was a wake-up call for him. He was like, I'm not getting anywhere fast with these guys.
No.
And I need to probably reassess who I am as a person before I can get better inside the ring as well. And he's done that, to be fair. He's done a 180. He's a totally new guy. And we spoke about it like backstage. He's totally different to what he was before. He was this arrogant guy before, but now he's complete 180. He's a pleasure to talk to now.
He's again that camaraderie I was mentioning before, like that I enjoy with this, and he's in the locker room with us,
yeah.
And he's chatting to us, and he's hanging out, and it's just like, you know, this is not the guy that I saw 6 months ago.
Yeah, where was this Omar before? In their VIP private area.
Yeah, when they were going to the ring, they would just walk past us, blank everyone, and now he's just like, hey guys, let's talk. And it's just like, it's really cool.
At least he's seen the light.
Yeah, he's seen the light. Hope, you know, maybe Asher will too. I don't know. As long as he's around Marcus Hunter, will that happen? Probably not.
I mean, I don't know. I mean, like, there's a big part of me that just thinks that Sebastian Asher is just kind of just, he's bad to the bone. It's not like, whereas with Omar, it feels like an influence thing.
Mm-hmm.
Sebastian, I think he's just,
as William Regal would say, he's born naughty.
Yeah.
Like he's again, he's another guy who like he wants to push his, throw his weight around and act like he's better than everyone. And you know what? You know, maybe he is, maybe he's not. But like, he just carries that arrogance. And
well, this is it. We all know how good Sebastian Asher is. There's no denying it.
Yeah.
But it's this added attitude that stinks.
Yeah.
And it makes him a very unlikable person, which is why I kind of outed him as a secret dancer, and he's not been happy that people have started to find out about that, because it doesn't fit his born naughty bad boy too cool for school image that I like.
But again, like look what happened like at our Abdomania show. He'd been parading around as the self-appointed junior heavyweight champion. Spike rightfully regains his belt.
Yeah.
What happens after that match? They shake hands, and I was watching, going like, is he grown a conscience? You know, it's going into Christmas, so is his heart did his heart grow 3 sizes that day? As I say, what do we see from this guy going forward? I thought we'd see something different.
No.
Obviously, at our last show, him and Omar had a confrontation.
Yeah.
In his, what's the segment called? What is
a moment of glory.
A moment of glory. Yeah. Like
a moment of glory, boss.
A moment of glory. And yeah, he had to be carried out because he was acting like a petulant child.
Yeah, he had a wee tantrum.
Raging. Yeah. Absolutely raging.
Omar did him.
Yeah.
Chucked him out of his ring. Chucked him out of his own show.
Yeah. So I'm looking forward to that just because I kind of want to see Sebastian Ashel possibly get what's coming to him.
Yeah. But a comeuppance, you like. Yeah. His way.
Mm-hmm. Bring him back down to earth. I think that's what he needs because he's not had that for a long time.
What are you saying, Titchick? What do you see happening in this match?
I mean, it's kind of hard to say because we've seen a lot of what Sebastian's been doing recently, and like, kind of offense to the guy, he's kind of been losing a lot, and I kind of feel like he needs this one.
Yeah,
you know, I kind of feel like.
Because if he kicks Omar out for being the supposed weak link and the result of the failure of Glory Hunt and Edge's attack team, and then he's, like you said, had a questionable title reign, loses the quote-unquote unification match, and if he then loses to his former tag team partner, where does that put him?
I mean, that's the thing. Like, it's one thing losing to, as you were mentioning before about Orglomania, it's one thing to lose to Spike Tierney.
Yes.
Who's one of the best wrestlers in the country, hands down. Not taking any notes, don't at me. It's an indisputable fact.
He's beat both of us.
He's beat
in a match in that same building that we're talking about.
He's been there, he's done that, he's a prodigy in many, many respects. So it's easy to see why even Sebastian can acknowledge like what's happened when he loses to somebody like Spike Tierney. Yeah. Losing to somebody like Omar Mohammed, considering the relationship that they've had, considering the fact that Omar has had this new change of heart, this new change of personality, he's coming back in with a more, let's say, amicable view on life, and to see all that sort of change, and if he loses to that, I don't know what that means for Sebastian Asher.
Yeah.
So part of me feels like he kind of needs to win this one, and I don't know. Maybe if he loses, it might humble him a little bit. Maybe if he wins, he might finally show us the hype that Marcus has been building up for.
How does he win as well, though? Does he cheat again? Does he use his? Because we've saw
his trusty brass knucks.
Yeah, he's pulled out those knucks quite a few times. Can he win a match?
Is that without them?
Can he win a match without Marcus, without the knucks, without some sort of shenanigans going on that he causes to win it? Can he just have a straight on less than match with Omar Mohammed and beat him? And I don't know if he can.
Because in the same way that winning is a habit, losing can also become a habit.
Mm.
And it's whether or not he can break that. Because, as we've been just talking about there, he's got his tactic. He's got Mark. He's got his Nux. It's not been working. If that's all he knows and that's not working, then what does he do? He's a bit stuck. I worry for Sebastian, because I'm like, well, you know, as good as you are, plan A is not working, but you don't seem to have a plan B.
I mean, it's kind of like going back to what you were saying before. I mean, when... You either have to break the losing or the losing will break you. Or it's going to break something. So, I mean... It's hard for me to pick who's going to come out on top on this one. I think maybe just for the kind of... How much it sort of means to him and how much it's sort of riding on it. I'm going to say Sebastian. Like... I don't like giving this guy any credit or any form of the benefit of the doubt, but I think there's a lot of riding on it for him. There's a lot of riding on it for Omar as well to prove that, you know, his way of thinking and his decision to depart from the usual tactics of glory hunting agencies that show that was a right decision. I don't feel that he has as much to prove as Sebastian does. Or at least, maybe not as much as Sebastian has to prove, but as much as something has to be proved to Sebastian, if that makes sense.
Yeah, I think Sebastian needs to prove to himself that he can beat Omar Muhammad.
I think Omar's going to win, but
I do
agree with your points about why Sebastian needs to win himself, but I don't think he can do the things that we've just said about not cheating or that.
And this, I think he's too far gone. Omar wasn't too far gone. We've seen that. He's managed to get himself out of this mindset. But Sebastian, how long has he been with Mark now? A couple of years? Maybe longer?
They got together when I joined the company.
Yeah,
Just after pandemic.
Pretty much as long as I've been in FCW, there's always been Marcus Glory Hunter and Sebastian.
They go hand in hand.
We came back, what, October 2021?
So there you go, just over 2 years.
Yeah.
That's a long time to ingrain a way of thinking in somebody. And like I said, it's plan A.
He's had his claws on him for a long time.
Mm-hmm. And I don't think it's done him any good. And I think he's too far gone. And I think Omar is going to do what a lot of people have done this year and find a way to beat Sebastian Asher, because Sebastian Asher's got one way of wrestling a match. He will try and beat you down, and if he doesn't get the job done straight away, he will immediately pull Mark into the match, or pull his knucks into the match. And if that doesn't fail, then you're going to win, because he doesn't know what to do.
I mean,
he needs a plan B. He needs to come up with something. He needs to. I don't know. I really worry for Sebastian, because I think without wanting to repeat myself, he's stuck in this rut, and I don't think that he sees that he's in a rut.
I mean, I kind of have to disagree with that one. From what I can see of Sebastian Asher, there has been times that he has went against the grain. He's went against the orders of Marcus himself. As much as Marcus has gotten sort of suckered in and maybe believing his own hype, he is his own man. So as much as he has been relying on this and he's got a lot riding on this match, I wouldn't be surprised at all if he actually does have a plan B.
Well, if you were going to give him some advice for this match, what would it be? If you were in his corner for this match, what would you be saying?
I mean, that's asking me to know what it's like to be with Sebastian Asher. And like, you know, the last time...
Not in a biblical sense.
Well, but I mean, you know, the last time that we were in the room together, it kind of ended up with me with a busted jaw. So, yeah. I mean, can you really see me in Sebastian Asher's corner in any way, shape or form?
I think Sebastian at this point has very much got the mindset of Jesse the Body Ventura, which is... win if you can, lose if you must, but always cheat. He's always going to do it.
Just who he is. Yeah.
Who he is at this point.
I mean, if anything, it's going to be interesting to see what the outcome of this is.
We're going to the end of the year. 2024 is just around the corner. Is he going to change, or is he just going to double down? Is he going to make...
History would suggest he's going to double down. Yeah. And you're probably right. But... it's very... Oh, look at that. We've spent about 10 minutes talking about that, I think, off the top of my head. It's a fascinating match for so many reasons.
I mean, just the absolute history that goes into this one pairing.
Yeah.
It's incredible. And again, it's as I was saying before, it's going to be interesting to see, at the very least. Like, I think I'm more interested to see what happens after everything. After the dust settles and... the winner has been declared. That's gonna be the more interesting thing, I think.
So we'll park that for now. Pick it up next month once we know what's happened. Duke, you pick the next match. Go for
it. Ooh, what am I going to pick? I'm going to pick Yuen G. Maki versus Liu King Sharp. Now, this one, wow. As we were talking about Maki earlier, the episodes that we've had with Maki on it is one of our highest listened episodes ever. It's what got us to become the number two wrestling podcast in Slovakia. I will keep bringing that up until the cows come home.
Yes.
But, yeah. What more can we actually say about Ewan G. Mackey, the man, the myth, the legend, the enigma wrapped in a green and black fursuit?
Yeah. I called this, the term dream match gets chucked around far too often in wrestling.
So does that phrase. That just gets chucked about far too much.
But, like, this.
Well, I mean, it's because we work in an industry where we all get chucked about. Yeah. It's.
But in terms of Scottish wrestling, this is a dream match. Mm. So it's going to be. I'm very glad SCW have this match.
I'm not gonna lie, I'm looking forward to seeing two of the kind of most unpredictable wrestlers in the Scottish scene at the moment coming together. And actually, like, I can't even finish that sentence because I don't know what's going to happen there. I don't. If there's a foil for Ewan G. Mackey in both the terms of, like, their similarities and their differences, it probably has to be Luke King Sharp. Mm-hmm. Like, Ewan G. Mackey and Luke King Sharp are two guys with huge personalities. They are the perfect example of, it's not the size of the dog in the fight, it's the size of the fight in the dog. Because again, they're two guys that you can see and maybe possibly think, oh, you know, they're smaller, they're not a threat or anything. Hell no. I would probably sooner go, like, 3 rounds in the ring with Tyson than take either of them on in any kind of fight. They are two of the best, two of the mainstays of the Scottish scene. And this match is kind of a perfect chance for a lot of people to see what both of these gentlemen can do when they're completely sort of unhinged by everything. I mean, that being said, I say unhinged from everything because we were discussing the fact that Mr. Ewan G. Mackey seemed to have a bit of a change of heart in the last match that he had against Bochico. So I'm kind of interested to see where that might factor into this match.
See, I don't know if it was a change of heart with Mackey. Having spent so much time with him, I don't know if it was a change of heart or if it was just Bochico and deservedly so finally earned some respect from Ewan, and Ewan doesn't give respect easily. And you said, you know, like, two of the most wild and unpredictable guys. That wild and unpredictable was certainly looking sharp. Ewan G. Mackey is not wild. Ewan G. Mackey is methodical and he's playing chess with you in his mind, and you're playing snakes and ladders. That you don't even know the amount of thought process that's going on in his head. And that's what makes him even almost more dangerous than looking sharp, in my opinion. It's just like, yeah, he might not need to use, he might not have, like, the weapons and everything else that Lou will use. Ewan will destroy you with his mind before he even gets in the ring with you. And, like, with this match, it absolutely is a dream match. And are these two mainstays of the Scottish scene? Absolutely. Is it something that, like, the FCW fans are going to love? Yeah. I don't think we can even predict a winner on this one because, like, they're so similar but so different at the same time. And to try and, like, be like, oh, well, it could be this and that. They both have reasons to win. Neither are not going to want to lose, obviously. No one wants to lose. How do you predict something involving Lou and Ewan that doesn't involve an absolute just anarchy of results that could occur in that match before we even get to the result?
There's a lot of variables.
Absolutely.
But I agree with Jay. Like, Ewan is very calculated. I know what you mean by, like, he does have that side to him. We've talked before about his nursery crimes, for example, in the background, that side of Ewan. But maybe when he's not in that environment, like, that's probably going to favour Ewan with it being a straight up wrestling match. Lou will not be able to maybe tap into the wild man as much in the confines of the rules. So maybe if this is like a hardcore match, or nursery crimes, whatever you want to call it, maybe it suits looking sharp.
But I think that's also the thing with, like,
but I don't think a straight up wrestling match is going to favour anyone other than Mackey.
I mean, I can definitely see where you're coming from on that front, but when it comes to the idea of being wild, it's how you said, like, Yuen Jimaki is very calculated. He's very methodical in his thinking. And yes, Liu Kang Sharp does use a lot of weapons, but the idea of being wild, especially in the sense of wrestling, isn't just about, you know, being a sort of like an animalistic style of person. It's about being someone that's beyond regular means of thinking. Yuen Jimaki is definitely that.
Yuen Jimaki is absolutely someone who does not think in any regular way. Absolutely about anything.
But at the same time, look at Liu Kang Sharp. Liu Kang Sharp is, like, again, he's a guy that you would maybe look at and think, oh, I can maybe take this guy in the fight. But he would run it in the ring and instantly take on the biggest people in that ring. I mean, I remember when we were last at the Bonner Hall, he had a match against Asylum and Dickie Divers and Caleb Valhalla. And it was, again, he was the smallest guy in that ring.
Set the place on fire. Yeah, it was amazing.
Yeah, absolutely set the place on fire that match. But that's the thing, like, it was three guys that just outsized him so much. He runs straight in.
Mm.
That's the scariest part about it. There's no
fear.
There's no fear. There's no self-preservation. Like, well, there is probably self-preservation in there.
I know.
But very minimalised. It's the reason why the honey badger is one of the scariest animals ever.
Yes.
Honey badger, don't give a fuck. And then, so, out of everything I expected to hear on the podcast, Honey Badger, bringing up was not what I was expecting.
But tell me the Liu Kang Sharp is not just a wrestling Honey Badger.
At the same time, just go back to what we were talking about earlier, Honey Badger versus a grizzly bear. Who wins?
Oh, God.
Oh.
Make it a triple threat. Get the girl in there as well, yeah.
I think that's also the interesting thing. It's the lack of fear of going in to a situation like this and taking it on. And again, looking sharp, and both you and Jimaki as well, both have that experience of like running in when the odds are against them, running into something that looks like they have no chance in and coming out on top. So when you take those two forces that defy most regular people's way of thinking and most people's logic and put them against each other, where does that come from? Like, where do you go from there?
Well, we have the Tom Atlas issue as well. How heavily involved in this match is he going to be?
Mm-hmm.
We saw him get involved multiple times against Bochco. It didn't work out well.
We also saw him have a little client fit afterwards, essentially, when Ewan was just like, no, Bochco won. Bochco beat me. Is Tom going to be able to contain himself if Ewan earns some respect for
Ewan might not want his help in this match because it didn't do him any favours against Bochco. So again, where does that put Tom?
I mean, yeah.
There's, again, so many different factors. East versus West as well. Ewan and Lou.
Yeah. Both sides of the country.
Yeah.
Duking it out. In the bout to knock the other guy out.
Money East.
Money. I mean, like, if we're going to have to go, like, try and pick someone, probably best going for the East Coast guy.
Yeah.
So, sorry, Lou, please don't bust my kneecaps.
I'm not picking someone. I'm not that stupid.
Right. We've put it off for a while now, and it's my pick, and I'm gonna bring it up.
Yeah.
Let's talk about Nathan North versus Bradley Evans.
Big Brad.
Yeah.
Big bruiser Brad.
Did not expect to see him.
I thought it was almost very poetic where I remember when you came out to congratulate Foundation a few months ago when they won the number one contenders match, and I remember, I can get this quote perfect, you said, you're going to have to bring everything to beat us.
They brought everything and more.
And that's exactly what they did.
Yeah.
Because I'm going to back my friend up here. They needed him to beat you guys. They needed him to take those tag team championships off you. But they got away with it.
They certainly did. Sorry, no, I'm just.
I know.
I'm not gonna. I'm still kind
of. It's not the way you wanted to, because you're not an idiot. You knew that the time would eventually come, but that's not the way anyone wants to lose a championship.
Yeah.
For those of you who don't know, Game On defended the tag team titles in your trilogy match with the Foundation, who in FCW anyway were Ryan Riley and Zach Dynamite. They'd been a trio in other parts of the country, but we'd never seen Bruiser Brad Evans in FCW. And we always thought, okay, well, this is obviously just Zach and Ryan's thing. They're the guys that are going to show up in FCW. And then, boom, lights go out during the match. Everything was going quite well for you up until then. And then the lights come back on, and this big behemoth of a man, Bruiser Brad Evans, is standing in the middle of the ring and helps his stablemates pick up the win and pick up the championships.
Yeah.
And it wasn't right. But unfortunately, that's where we're at. But do you know what, Duke, right? You've got that to potentially soften the blow a bit. They needed to cheat. They needed to use their big enforcer to beat you guys. And at least now Nathan's got a chance to avenge it somewhat in wrestling Brad.
Yeah, I mean, I think...
Would you have liked to have been the guy in there?
No.
Avenging it?
No, I mean, I see why it's appropriate for Nathan to be in there against Brad. I mean, as an example, you and me, Jay, we came up together. Yep. We've been through a lot together.
We started training together the same night. And you were the first person I spoke to, and our paths diverged for a period of time. But we got back together.
Like everything sort of came back in from there. And I know that Nathan and Brad came up together many, many moons ago.
I didn't know that, so that's interesting.
They've known each other since day one.
Okay.
In fact, I think they actually knew each other before wrestling as well.
Wow.
So I think the person who's sort of been the most surprised out of everything has been Nathan. The fact that we knew that Brad has been a part of the foundation has been for a while.
Yeah. Just not in FCW.
But also, I just don't think that Nathan was... I don't think Nathan was prepared to see what his one of his best friends is willing to do in order to come out on top. Or at least see what the people he really considers friends are willing to do to come out on top. You know?
Yeah.
And... I know, I mean, like, I'd...
How's Nathan been coping since? Like, he must be pretty caught up about it.
Honestly, we haven't really talked much since it happened. I think he's in a little bit of shock, to say the least. I mean, I've tried reaching out again and haven't really heard much back. This song and dance again, but we haven't really spoken too much. I think like he's been through quite a lot.
Yeah, he has.
In that regard.
Yeah.
He has.
This is just the latest thing.
Yeah. A
ton of bricks to fall on top of him.
Yeah. But I don't know, I mean, when he has this match with Brad, I definitely want to show Nathan what he means to me, you know? I mean, he's taught me a lot.
Mm-hmm.
Ever since I came into FCW, Nathan North has been there. I mentioned it in the first episode of this podcast when we and I interviewed him. That's when I first came up with the 5 questions to do.
Yeah.
You know, we spoke there and I mentioned about how he's always been there in FCW. I've always been in a tag team with him. So I think it's important to sort of show him exactly what all these times that we spent together, these many months, years.
Well, you've achieved so much. Like,
yeah.
Not only did you win the tag team championships, you saved the company together. So, and when you did drop the titles, it wasn't the way that anyone should be dropping titles. It was because of outside interference.
Yeah.
So, you guys have went through wars together. I mean, I remember the table match against Legend.
Oh God.
Like that was
groundbreaking stuff. Literally.
Yeah. I was helping out as a referee that night. I saw you and Tommy Claus go for that table, and Chris Quinn that night. I tried who is this? And because it's just like you just went through at the same time. Who do we pick? Do we pick the guys who have worked so hard? Or it's just like, no, we just have to restart. And you, obviously, you guys like the match continued the way it did and that, but like you guys have went in 2 years that you guys have essentially, well, just short of 2 years that you guys have been together, you guys have been through so much title reigns, wars against Ledgate, wars against Foundation of the Future. I mean, name a tag team in it that we've had in SCW that you guys haven't wrestled yet. You've wrestled everyone, you beat them all, now one of them's beat you.
Yeah, and I mean, like, it's
hopefully this is the start of you guys working your way back to where you belong now, because it was the most tainted of victories possible.
Yeah, so, I mean, at any rate, there's definitely some work that has to be put in.
Yeah, I'm not meaning to like prod it or whatever.
It's fine. It's I mean, what happened happened. I can't go back. I can't change history. I can't get those titles back on us. All we can do is, you know,
look. Go for lane number two.
Yeah. Focus on what's in front of you right now.
Well, look to see where our mistakes are, where our weaknesses are, learn from that, and then progress.
Yeah.
That's all.
Keep moving forward, Joe.
Yeah, that's all that a person can really do.
Yeah.
But no, I'm going to be there in Nathan's corner. Yeah. I'm going to be, you know, showing him how much he means to me.
Good. Hopefully, I've got faith. Mm-hmm. Hopefully Nathan can avenge this. So, Jay, we'll come back to you. Got a few more things to talk about.
I think Andy Roberts, Tommy Cartel, and versus the Meat Factory.
I'm buzzing that they're back as a tag team. It's been a long time. I think the last time I remember was maybe the Tayport show.
I believe so.
Back in February, last time as a tag team. And again, there's a lot of history around this match as well. Obviously, back at Nay Mercy, Andy Roberts took on John Kerr.
Decimated him.
Yes, left him laying.
Craig made the save that night.
Fast forward a few months, back at Ardler Complex for Ardler Mania, takes on Craig.
Decimates him.
Yep.
John Kerr makes the save.
Yep. And so I think it was only fitting that they're now meeting in a tag team contest, because they both now need revenge on Andy Roberts. And Andy Roberts has picked Tommy Cartel to tag with him to take on the Meat Factory. What were we thinking about this one?
I think no matter what, at the end of this match, like, I've got history with John Kerr. Like, we've faced each other quite a few times, and he's never beat me. But you cannot underestimate the strength, the power, the determination that this man has. And Andy Roberts definitely kicked the crap out of both of those guys in separate matches, and they will be looking for some sort of payback, just to remind Andy Roberts that, like, you don't take these boys lightly. They're big lads, and they need, and you should be scared about taking them on.
I mean, they're one of the best tag teams in the country, let's be honest. And he's like I said, he's decimated them both in singles matches, but he's in their house now. He's in the tag team match, and I'm fully behind the Meat Factory in this. I think they're gunning for Andy. I think the walls are closing in a bit now. He's had his fun, but I think the Meat Factory are going to get the revenge. I think it's going to be glorious, because they're honest. I love watching them wrestle as a tandem. I think it's fun. Some of the things they can do are just unbelievable. I'm a big fan. big fan of the Meat Factory. I love them, watching them wrestle, and I think they're going to destroy Andy Roberts and Tommy Cartel. I'm very confident of that.
And the wild card, of course, is Cartel, because we've not saw much of him here.
No,
like he's been different places. I think he was here for the Fair City Rumble.
Yeah, he was in the Rumble. We did like a house show in Tayport as well. So I was speaking about the Meat Factory before. It was our last televised show at Tayport, where they last wrestled. We did a house show in Tayport a few months ago as well, and Tommy might have wrestled Sebastian Asher that night, if I remember correctly.
And to say the same show that I wrestled the Power on with Randy Valentine.
It was, yes. And you used, which rule was it again?
Oh, it was an amendment to the Freebird rule. I can't remember. I believe it was Chapter 8, Subsection 11.
Yeah, genius play by yourself.
I mean, hey, like, I'm the guy who collects rule books for a living.
Yeah.
I won that for a living.
He wishes he did it for a living.
If I did it for a living, I would be absolutely sorted. But no, it's a very enthusiastic hobby. Yeah. And Marcus the Glory Hunter didn't think that I was going to look at our own rulebook.
Yeah.
You know, it's just... I mean, that was a fault on his own.
Yeah.
Like, he really didn't think that one through.
Don't expect like the tabletop gamer not to look into the rulebook.
Yeah, I had to, you know, it was another time that Nathan wasn't able to make it, and I had to, you know, solve the issues myself.
Yeah,
but like I was saying, like, as Tommy Cartel, we've saw him in the lumber, we've saw him at the social. What do we know about him that really?
Not a whole lot,
but Andy.
I know that some people call him Tony Cartwheel.
Andy Roberts is a very smart man. He's a very smart wrestler, and he picked Cartel for a reason. He obviously feels that this guy's got something that can counteract whatever the meat factor is.
Well, I mean, then don't get me wrong. I'm not discrediting Andy Roberts as a wrestler. We all know how good he is. Again, I'll say it again though. A singles wrestler, it's a different game. You know this.
Oh no!
Pun intended. It's a different game. Tag team wrestling is so different to singles wrestling.
It honestly is.
And I knew this anyway. Back when I was just a fan, as soon as I've come into DAPW, you find out even more how different tag team wrestling actually is.
I mean, when it comes to tag team wrestling, you need to have a synergy with your partner.
And does he have that with Tommy Cartel? Probably not. And definitely not to the level of John Kerr and Craig Berry.
It's they just work as one complete, absolute unit.
Yep.
They are
a unit.
that like their head and shoulders above in that regard, because they're not just like tag partners; they're friends as well. You know, they're always there for each other. They're always looking at where there's one, you will see the other. They've got each other's backs.
Yeah. 24/7.
It's one of the most important things that you can have. Like, again, I don't think either of them have left the other one out to dry. I don't think either of them have let the other one down in any way, shape, or form. That can, you know, sort of shows like a real weakness to a team.
Yeah.
So it's so they are incredible together. So that's why honestly, and
this is without a motive. They have a motive in this match.
They actually have something behind them. They have a reason to target this guy. Maybe not so much Tommy Cartel, but that's the thing. Like, Tommy, if he doesn't know what he's getting himself into, that's on him.
He's going to get caught in a crossfire.
He's going to get caught in an absolute crossfire.
It's no secret that Andy Roberts obviously runs
Power Pro
Wrestling School in Fife and Livingston. Tommy Cartel's one of the students.
He's one of the standouts.
Yeah.
I know that.
I come back to the same thing. He's picked him for a reason. He's obviously seen something in Tommy Cartel that he thinks is going to counteract whatever the meat factor he's got for him.
Because Andy knows how good they are. So he's going to pick somebody who he thinks is on that level.
Absolutely.
I still think the meat factor are going to...
Meat factor all the way.
Yeah.
Like,
I think they're future FCW tag team champions.
I might be a vegan, but give me that meat. Yeah.
I think they're at that level. I think future champions. I guess it's a question of when, not if, for them. This could just be a bit of a roadblock for them. They need to, pun very much intended, squash this beef they have with Andy Roberts. I think before they can move on.
Does beating Andy Roberts and Tommy Cartel set them up for a tag team title shot later on, though?
That is a question for Kevin Williams, isn't it? But hey, it can't hurt. Can't hurt.
Yeah, I could see.
I don't think that's the goal. I don't think right now. I think they're very singularly minded, focused on Andy Roberts. But as someone in the back, or even just like sitting here, could say as a fan, where do they go next after this? Because it's this. You know, once this beef is squashed, where do they go?
I think you're right. I think it's like if there's gonna be anyone. Like any sort of successor to the tag belts, I think they're definitely a good choice.
Nah, screw that. Get your belts back and wrestle the Meat Factory. That's the match I really wanted to see.
Yeah.
That is the match I really wanted to see.
But they are like hungry young men.
Yes.
Hungry young men who are going to want, they're going to want to be champions. No one gets in this business to not be a champion.
Checks and championships, baby.
Yeah. That's what it's all about. It's not hot dogs and handshakes.
Nah. Despite what John Moxley might tell you. But yeah, we all go in Meat Factory.
Meat Factory have my vote.
It's got to be them. So, I'm going to jump ahead of you, right? And pick again. Because I spoke to the commissioner this morning.
Ooh.
I've got some big news.
Right? Oh.
It's bigger than R-Truth coming back. It's bigger than Randy Orton coming back. It's bigger than CM Punk coming back.
No one can see this, but I'm currently rubbing my eyes.
Yeah, vigorously.
Vigorously.
I have it on good authority that for the first time in, I think, it'll be 11 years, Santa's wrestling. He's coming to a wrestling show. I don't know if he's wrestling, I will point that out there. I'm excited. Santa.
Are you saying that St. Nicholas, the guy who rides in a sleigh across the night sky, around the world, in 24 hours, delivering presents to children, is going to be at Fair City Wrestling?
He's finally recovered from Alberto Del Rio running him over with his BMW.
Well, it's about damn time. I remember asking specifically for a Millennium Falcon Lego set, and he never got me it. And that year, and fair enough, Alberto Del Rio.
No, but what was that? Was it the £700 set?
Oh, of course, yeah.
That only came out like 3 years ago.
He
gives presents to kids, not big kids.
Don't listen to him.
I'm just bitter because he never gave me one.
I know, yeah.
Nobody said that I couldn't still write to him.
No, quite right too.
Yeah.
But yeah, Santa.
He likes back. Please stop writing to
him. Santa.
You have a beard.
Santa is making his return to wrestling. That's how I should have phrased it. I don't think
it's his busy time of year. Is he going to have time to come and get away from the North Pole?
Everyone has got time for FCW, J. Robin. You know this.
Surely you could have done this. Like, this is busy period. Yeah. Who's going to be in charge of the elves?
Mrs. Claus will hold things down.
Oh, okay.
She's a strong, independent woman.
Just dump all his wife on his missus. I'll see how it is.
But yeah, I've got it on good authority that Santa will be making an appearance at FCW.
Well,
fight before Christmas.
Colour me red because, wow, I'm excited. So what, is he wrestling someone?
I mean, I've not been told that, but I'd love to see it. Here's an interesting thing. Who on the FCW roster that is not already booked on the show would you like to take on Santa Claus?
Me.
Caleb Valhalla.
No, me. I'm the one who dresses like a Christmas ornament.
That's true. I'm Santa. Red and green. I love that.
I'm wearing red and sparkly green. I look like a Christmas ornament. Like, give me Santa.
I like the continuity there, though. It doesn't matter who gets offered in the match. ADM, Santa Claus, first man with his hand up. I'll do it.
Yeah. No, I would say, well, either Caleb or myself, but only with the stipulation that if I win, I get that Millennium Falcon Lego set.
I think that's fair.
I think that's only fair.
Could we have it in like a ladder match and it's like suspended from the roof of the...
No, because then I'm in that match because I want that set too.
Oh, triple threat. There you go.
Sorry. I've wanted that Millennium Falcon for years. Ever since it was announced, or I was like,
we just had a ladder match recently, so we could have like a pole match on a pole match. Millennium Falcon on a pole match.
Oh, I'm never winning that. I'm Duke.
Sorry. You've got to win the pole match. You're half Polish. it's our signature match.
Surely
do it for the do it for
surely
the
our signature match is a hammer on a pole.
Just you wait. 2024 is a big year. That's what I'll be bringing to the table.
I'm never going to beat Duke in a pole match. Like, the man knows what he's doing around the pole.
Oh, I know what I'm doing around the pole. Yeah.
Yuji Maki special guest referee. But
oh, that pole, sorry.
But yeah, so that's exciting. Santa's coming home to FCW.
Santa Claus is coming to town.
He's coming.
Just one second, because we're talking about the pole. Obviously, Anthony and Mercy, the main event, Yuji Maki versus Johnny Lyons, started with Yuji Maki. Controversially, so... doing a performance on a pole.
Mm.
My boyfriend had never saw a pole match before, did not know it existed. He was there with one of his friends who's an old school wrestling fan and did know about it. And when the pole came out, my boyfriend did turn to his friend and say, "What's this about?" And at which point his friend said, "Oh, they must be doing a pole match for the title."
Imagine.
So they legitimately thought it was going to be the title belt on a pole match at the start, as the main event. Unadvertised.
Last minute change of. Card subject to change. That's Johnny Lyons.
Card subject to change. It's no longer just a singles match, it's a title on a pole match.
I've just got images now of like Johnny Lyons diving off the balcony, grabbing the belt on his way down. That would have worked.
It's like spinning, like holding onto it from one leg, like he's doing a shift at Private Eyes.
Yes. And again, I've kind of taken over the card here, Duke. I'm sorry, but there is one more thing we need to talk about before we go on about the FCW Heavyweight Championship match.
It is
the fact that Brody Adler ran the gauntlet last month, became the first ever women's Game Changer briefcase holder. Could we see her potentially doing something on this show? Could she cash it in? She might just walk out and say, "Serena Rose, get out of here right now. We're having a match."
Yeah, I mean, that is...
Anything could happen.
That is a good point. And I mean,
I just wanted to put that idea out there because, you know, she's been calling her out on social media. We've had wanted posters all over Facebook and Instagram. TikTok.
She has said she kidnapped her best friend.
Yeah.
But I think also, like, not only that, I mean, it's as you sort of said, I think it was on... I can't remember what month it was, but it was the when Serena Rose was fighting Moxie Malone. And
might have been the first match she had with Moxie, a couple months. Anyway, regardless.
But we did mention the fact that there seems to be a bit of a crack in Serena's confidence a little bit. I mean, it was when she was starting to use chop to the face. A very underhanded tactic for an incredibly accomplished and skilled wrestler to do. Usually it's something that happens when there's a little bit of fear
doubt.
Yeah. Like making sure that you've got that again, it's as we were saying before, win if you can, lose if you must, but always cheat. For her it's always win.
Yeah.
Never lose. Mm-hmm. And rarely cheat.
Yeah. Yeah, we hadn't really seen that up until that point. And that threw me. I did kind of pose that question to her on commentary for the Gauntlet match, but she was very dismissive, as you would imagine.
So maybe is this...
Conveniently never defended her title that night either as well. Yeah. So maybe she was quite happily to use that.
So I say it's maybe... it's
either, night off, you know?
So I don't know if she's maybe going to do, you know, like strike while the iron's hot and try and exploit that, or maybe leave it a little bit and see if that breeds maybe a little bit more weakness in Serena.
Mm, maybe try and grind her down mentally before her potential cash-in.
But at the same time, like, as I was saying before, like, strike while the air is hot, like, a surprise attack, it's maybe not something that she would expect. I mean, we've had, I think it was at the Fair City Rumble that we had the Game Changer cashed in on the same night.
Yeah.
So that might be something that Serena's expecting.
Serena was involved in that.
Yeah.
Yeah. But at the same time, it also might be the thing of, like, because she's expecting it, she doesn't think that it's going to happen because everyone's sort of suspecting it, so she won't suspect it. I don't know if I'm overcomplicating
things. I think these are the exact thoughts that are going around the champion's mind. It's a very mentally taxing thing to have that briefcase of Damocles above you.
I don't think that's how cocksure this podcast was.
Learned men on here, right?
Bringing up Damocles, amazing.
Yeah.
But, I mean,
it's university.
I mean,
it doesn't do English, but you know.
Doesn't count if you just walk through the
building. That's true, yeah.
But I mean, it's as we said before, like, the briefcase is arguably maybe a bit more valuable than the titles in terms of having it. Because titles, again, it shows that you're the best in, the best one out there in your division at that time.
Yeah.
But the Game Changer means that can change at any
for a whole year.
Moment. Yeah. For an entire year, you've got that panic. You've got that... You've got something that means that you are not safe. There's nobody... This is somebody who doesn't have to earn their shot. This is somebody who you can't keep watching through to see how they're progressing on the way up to you. This is somebody that can blindside you at a moment's notice.
Which brings up your point about why is she cheating? You guys have brought up Serena cheating. okay, she's cheating. You guys are saying, the way you guys are talking, Bloody's going to cash in and win the belt. Guaranteed. Maybe that's why she's cheating. Because she knows the game changer was announced. That's when we started seeing things like her cheating. Mm-hmm. That's when she started, the cog started turning. That's what I'm saying there. The cog started turning in her head. She's going like, there's going to be a briefcase that will guarantee someone anytime to come after me. How do I fight against that, not knowing when the attack's going to come? Cheat. Mm. Throw something in the face. Use a weapon. Do whatever she's doing. Like, is that why? We're all assuming that Bloody's going to cash in and win, because realistically, that is the most likely outcome. Because you can't blindside them.
Statistically speaking, through concepts like this in other wrestling companies, it's usually in the favour of the briefcase holder that would come out in a match like this.
But Bloody's been doing this for, 5 years? 4 years? Selena's been doing this for how long? And this is not a comment about her being older, this is a comment about her experience.
Yeah, it's just a fact.
She, like, there's a reason why they call her the first woman of ladies wrestling in Scotland. Like, she has probably more experience than all the women that she's been brought in to face off against. Who can, like, and she now walked out, hey, if I want to hold on to this belt, a belt that, again, she's never actually lost that belt.
True.
She was the first women's champion, but she never lost the belt. She had to have someone substitute for her, and they lost that belt. She's never been pinned for it. She's never submitted. She obviously loves that belt. She obviously doesn't want to lose it. She's cheating for a reason. I think she's practicing. So if Bloody does come after her, whether it's this show, whether it's the next, whether it's a year down the line, she's going to be holding on. I think Selena's still going to hold that belt.
Could be one of those, even if, like you said, Brody cashes in, Serena just maybe even blatantly cheats in front of the ref. Mm-hmm. Boom, DQ, there goes your title shot.
Cash in. She cashes in.
Count out.
Get out and walk away.
See you later.
I mean, that's the thing, that's the thing with the game changers. Like, it guarantees you a shot at the title. It doesn't guarantee you the title.
Exactly. It's
it's a scary thing for a champion to sort of have hanging over their head, but again, it doesn't mean that the person holding it is automatically going to win. You still have to fight for what you want to get. You still have to study your opponent and know when to use that tool. Mm-hmm. And it's whether Brody can use that tool well or not.
Does she have the experience and know to use it as effectively as it can be used?
Yeah.
Because it's not just a case of, like we just said, it's not just a case of, here's the briefcase, give me my belt.
Yeah.
Here's the briefcase, now I have to put in some work.
You still have to defeat the most dominant wrestler in FCW history. That was fact.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Undefeated.
Brody needs to play this as smartly as she can, whether it's where she cashes it in, or if it's post-match, pre-match, mid-match, whatever type of match. She's got to think of all these things. Mm-hmm. So it's going to be fascinating to see where this goes, but I think Before Christmas is the first opportunity where potentially we could see a FCW title match, mm-hmm, in the women's division, Brody versus Serena. So we'll see.
Yeah.
We'll see what happens. But let's talk about the heavyweight title match.
Let's talk about this heavyweight title match.
Oh, I'm excited. I'm excited for this.
So it is going to be Dickie Divers versus Randy Valentine. Arguably FCW's most hated man versus FCW's most loved man. Honestly, for me, I'm just going to come out and say it. I hate Dickie Divers. I've never made.
I thought he was going to say, I love Randy Valentine.
Yeah. Former tag team partner.
I do love my former tag team partner. He stepped up to help me when I needed him. That's how I ended up getting involved with
Team Williams, was it? Williams, yeah, well. He joined that night, I remember.
Yeah, I mean, that was part of the thing. Like, I remember when Commissioner Williams first brought us in. That was the night that me and Nathan were separated by Marcus the Glory Hunter. It was through that me and Kevin were discussing some of the other members that we were going to get as a part of it, getting Randy Valentine to be one of the people in Team FCW was, you know, always going to be a given there. We knew that he was going to look for any reason to go against Marcus Hunter, which is also why I got him on board, because it was like, well, if there's one person that I want to help piss off Marcus Hunter, it's the guy who has made his entire career in FCW pissing off Marcus Hunter.
Now, don't forget about that night though, that you guys teamed up. Marcus was trying to humiliate Randy by making him sit on the merch table and sell tickets and sell t-shirts and all our various apparel that we sell. He was trying to get the guy, no, I don't want you on my show, because this is when Marcus obviously owned FCW. He was trying to send a message to Randy. Randy wasn't going to stand for that. Randy did come out. Randy did sneak off, go to the toilet, somehow have a meeting with Duke and be like, hey, let's do something.
I found a bylaw.
Have you read the little bit, yeah, son?
Because I have.
And we saw that match, and you guys pulled it off that night. You defended the tag titles, you retained the tag titles. But it's just like, Randy has... there's an attitude about Randy, because obviously he spent so much time away from active in-ring competition. Randy coming back in, there's a lot of people, I think Dickie Divers probably included, underestimating despite what we've saw him do over the past year, I think they underestimate what he can do and what he's still got in the tank. And I think Randy, it's not going to be the easiest match in the world for Dickie Divers, because Randy's got a point to prove about it.
And I think the thing is, as well, that like, Randy's pure ferocity carries him through, where, again, like you say, a lot of people can underestimate Randy because, you know, he's the old dog sort of coming back in. But you always fail to realise that means that he has more experience than anyone else. He's taken the knocks and he's not scared to take any more.
How long was he out? What was he doing in that time? He was still involved in Leicester. He sat there watching. Yeah. He sat there watching every single one of us. Whether it was, like, no matter where we were, he was watching Leicester and seeing what was happening, who was doing what and how they were doing it, and like, and formulating how if and when he came back, which he did at the 2022 Fair City Lumble, shocking return, he came in with a plan of going out. He's going to go after certain people. He went after Marcus the Glory Hunter. He ended up beating him. He ended up, you know, having to eat some clothes for a bit by getting put on match, and Marcus trying to mess with him. But he got his own back by teaming with Duke Cannon. What's next after that? It's going to be, no one gets in this business not to go after championships. He wants to be a champion.
He had a very good showing in the Rumble as well, Randy,
yeah,
this year.
He wants to be a champion. And Dickie Divers is at the top of the mountain in FCW. He's going after, Randy is going after this belt for a reason. It's a point to prove, and it's a point to show that he might be let low.
Yeah.
But he can still kick your ass.
Yeah. There'll be some story if he can come back after that time off in the ring and just over a year later win the top prize in the company.
Yeah, absolutely.
Whether he does or not, I don't know.
Yeah.
Because
Dickie Divers has shown that he's willing to do anything
hand on that. That was very... I've only been commentating for a short time. That was by and away the hardest match I've ever had to call. Divers versus Ambrose. Because
mm-hmm.
Me and Duke have spoke about this before. Like, and Jay, you're the same. Ambrose is one of our main trainers at school.
Yep.
So to see a man that, like, not only you admire as a wrestler, but you respect, and like, I class him as a friend now.
Yeah, he's not.
So to see like somebody who has meant a lot to you over the past year since I've been doing this go through that hell that Diver's put him through.
Which time?
Well, exactly. I mean, like, the Last Man Standing match was brutal enough, and then we'd had to watch him. We spoke about this before, back in February in Tayport. Diver's just mercilessly injured Ambrose for the first time this year. Back then, you stepped up to play last night at a match with that match with Divers. So, and he's just destroyed him, like, physically, several times.
Mm-hmm.
And this was just one battle too many for Ambrose to overcome. Divers has now got what he wants, and I can't see him relinquishing it anytime soon. Because
Eddie Divers has been single-minded in his approach to two things: hurting Ian Ambrose and getting his
heart. Yeah, ruthless. Game. Absolutely ruthless.
Is it, I mean, the first show back after the pandemic, there was a pre-show match that was guys from the Dundee Academy of Pro Wrestling having a battle royal. Divers comes out at the end and attacks us all. Why? Just to send a statement that he could.
Yeah.
Then at the end of the show, he was in the main event of that show, challenging for the world for the heavyweight title against Caleb O'Hara. Caleb won that night. A few months later, you know, like a year that we're going into the Fair City Lumber, and he starts, he faces off. He has some sort of confrontation with Ian Ambrose in that match. That's carried them to the past year in hating each other. And that's just like, when we talk about what Dickie Divers has done in FCW, he did win the Fair City Lumber. He did win the belt. He is the champion. He's top of the mountain. That also means there's a lot of people gunning after them. And then again, when I go about the Fair City Lumber, where Divers and Ambrose first goes on like that, when Randy comes out, go back, watch the footage. The first thing he does when he gets on the apron is he points at Dickie Divers and says, "You."
I remember.
How long has Valentine been planning this in his head? How many times has he already wrestled Divers in his head? How's he going to counter everything he does? Is Valentine, you know, Valentine's got this match. That he's had this match in his head for a long time, and he's finally getting it, and now there's gold on the line.
I mean, I think you're definitely right. I think Randy's going to be very privy to a lot of Divers' tricks. I think a lot of it comes down to how much tricks Divers can pull out. Can he pull out something that Randy hasn't seen before? Because I think you're right, I think Randy is going to look for every single way that he can counter the offensive of Dickie Divers. But in a rare moment where I'll give Dickie Divers any form of credit for anything, the guy knows what he's doing. The guy's got a tactical mind. The guy can stay one step ahead. I mean, I wouldn't be surprised if during our match at Ardomania, if he, you know, spoke to ADM about finding a way to take my leg out after he took my leg out. I wouldn't be surprised if that was like a plan from the start.
Yep.
The way that I got entangled up in that match. So I think a lot of it is just like, you know, can Randy keep reposting every single thing the Divers throws at him? That is going to be the biggest sort of factor in this match, I believe. So I find it hard to pick. When my heart says Randy, heart screams Randy Valentine.
Absolutely does. We all love Randy. Randy's. It came in, and obviously I was not associated with him much until recently, but like when I did come over to the other locker room and Randy was there opening me with open arms, has talked to me, has given me advice since I got there. I want to see Randy hold that belt. But like you just said, Divers is a wily guy. Like, he's got some tricks that even Randy might not know about.
And he's got the FCW Women's Champion as well. I mean, we spoke earlier that yes, he won the Rumble. Yes, he won the title later that night. Who helped him win both? You know?
Yeah.
Behind every strong man, there's a woman rolling her eyes and hitting people in the dick.
Yeah. I mean, I would appreciate it if my wife could do that for me, but sadly she's not in the wrestling business yet.
There's still time.
She'll take some convincing, but you know.
But that does take...
Honey, can you help me win the belt tonight? Yeah.
Can you give someone a DDT?
But that does take us to the end of our episode for this month.
It's been fun.
It's been really good.
Thank
yeah.
you, I don't know if people normally comment on matches as much as I have, but it's been fun.
I mean, we've had like different levels. Some people are maybe a bit more invested than others. But no, it's been fantastic having you on. I'm glad that we're able to get more people from the Dundee Academy of Pro Wrestling in the studio and getting to know them all a little bit better, because we are, you know, we're the guys who are going to be on the shows.
Mm-hmm.
And whether we're maybe stepping into the ring for the first time or the 50th time, this is an absolutely amazing way to get to introduce everyone to the world.
Mm-hmm.
So, again, thank you so much for coming in. Thank you very much for gracing us with your presence. Would you like to tell everyone where people can find you?
So everything is at JLobinPlo, so it's easy to find me. So at JLobinPlo on Facebook, X, and Instagram.
Don't call it X.
X, formerly known as Twitter. It's what it is. If I say Twitter, people might not know. What if people listen to this in 10 years?
That's true.
And they're just like, what's Twitter? I have to say. So
if it's still X in 10 years, I'll eat my own feet.
Well, clip that, ladies and gentlemen. But aye, we'll wrap up there. So we've been good. We've plugged the show. We shouted out the ticket link earlier on, didn't we? We'll shout out again.
And we'll shout out again.
Is this part of it? Yeah. This part of the recording?
Yeah, excellent. It is. Yeah.
Excellent. I'm
yeah. Like we're so professional. Yeah,
the editor is going to have a hell of a job.
Flash does a good job.
Hey, what is that time? 6 hours and 19 minutes. Wow.
So. FairCityWrestling.com for all your tickets. It's, look at the date, right? It is Friday, December 8th.
December 8th.
Tulloch Institute in Perth, or the Empire Zone, Jay.
The Empire Zone.
You will like that name eventually.
I will not.
I won't reveal who we've got on next month, but we all know, we've mentioned the APW. We do have a student showcase show in January, and the guest will be another DAPW student. I'm looking forward to getting him on the podcast and talking not just FCW but DEPW next month. That's going to be something to look forward to.
No, you mentioned him. Yeah, no, I'm.
Should we not tell them what we actually call the school?
Dab-dub.
Dab-dub.
Yeah, it's better. Yeah,
Dab-dub is it's just much better.
It just rolls off the tongue, doesn't it?
Yeah.
I'm equally looking forward to. Next month.
Someone was saying to me at the last show that they don't enjoy.
Tell us after the con.
Yeah. They were
they're wrong. They
heard that there's I'll hear you guys calling it dab dub.
No.
And they shook their head.
It's easier.
And said some words, but I'll tell you after the con.
I could probably guess who it is, but you know. But yeah, so I've been Patrick Peterski.
And I have been Duke Cannon, and you've been fantastic. Thank you very much for tuning into this month's episode of the Fair City Wrestling Podcast. Hopefully we will see you all there on the 8th of December at the Tulloch Institute. But until then, we'll see you next time.
So is the Honey Badger also getting the same prep time as the Gorilla and the Bear?
Absolutely not. It has to get the same prep time, surely. Otherwise it's not fair.
I mean, does a Honey Badger really need prep time? Like, they seem very much go, go, go.
There's a Formula One driver called Daniel Ricciardo, and his nickname is the Honey Badger.
And I just imagine, Headstrong by Trapped starts playing in their heads. It's just like, back off! I need you all! Get home! I need you all!